My name is Piet Hendricks. I'm an advisor at the European Association of Distance Teaching Universities. And formerly, my career was in Keulen. From both places, I have a lot of experience in collaboration and mobility, university collaboration and mobility. And so we had already a lot of projects on mobility and collaboration. Kunt je de slide pakken?
Je kunt op next drukken.
Op.
Op next. Ja, volgende.
Oké. Okay. Okay, on both places, we had a lot of experience, but now, recently in EDTU, we had a task force, virtual mobility, which was looking for a definition of virtual mobility, perhaps, as well, but for sure also for mapping different kinds of virtual mobility in European universities today. And also recent developments in that area. With the results of the task force, we went to a peer learning activity where also other people were present, people from the European Commission, from ministries, from agencies like DRD, DICO in Norway, ACA, and a lot of universities. So these were different steps towards the report, which I will explain to you very shortly. But first of all, you all know, but it's good from time to time to have a scheme about developments on mobility, European developments in mobility. And in 87, we started our Europe, the European Union started with the physical Erasmus mobility, physical Erasmus exchange, with also intensive programs, you remember, or some of you remember. And rapidly, universities started also with a kind of networking between university programs with mobility windows. And there are a lot of examples in universities, and also in our report, we have adopted a lot of examples of network programs with mobility windows. Later on, we got the Erasmus Mundus joint degree program, master degrees, doctoral degrees, where mobility was embedded in the program, not only for students, but also, of course, for staff, because it was a joint program, and staff and students were part of the program, which was organized by different universities jointly. And later on, we had the Erasmus Strategic Partnerships, Knowledge Alliances, Capacity Building Initiatives. And there we have seen that also very rapidly, very small scale initiatives of mobility emerged. And for example, virtual seminars, virtual projects, learning communities, joint online course, and so on. So all these kinds of initiatives for very small scale and actually in an international collaboration online, easily also easily to organize. And so this was also a very important step, I think. And when we look into practice, very many of these initiatives, mobility initiatives, online mobility initiatives, have started under strategic partnerships. And most recently, of course, the European Commission has started a completely new policy with regard to European universities, a European university. I don't talk about the history of that initiative, but it's important to say that European universities or alliances or networks of universities where they collaborate among them in joint or networked university programs in all kinds of subjects. and mobility takes place. And the aim of the commission was also, but also of the universities participating in these university networks, the aim was to achieve mobility figures, mobility rates of 50% for a university. But then you apply also online mobility and you combine both. And we see that also in recent projects, the aim is to that 100% of all students can take part in mobility schemes. Also, a recent initiative at the European Commission is the EU University Hub. And it's the OpenU project, as it is called to today. And that's the hub will contain different parts. One part is to facilitate the accessibility to all kinds of online courses in European universities or blended courses in European universities, and also to organize mobility with these courses in European universities. That's one aspect. The other aspect is more teaching staff training, continuous professional education of staff, where staff will have the opportunity to develop ideas and to develop competences with regard to blended education, online education, and continuous online education, MOOCs development, and so on. Actually, what staff will do in internationalization in the future when it is online is to work with innovative educational formats, not only joint programs, it can also be, like we said already, virtual seminars, or as we see later on with Katrien, think tanks, and so on. And also mobility formats, innovative mobility formats. The classical mobility format is the Erasmus scheme, where students exchange or exchange between universities for certain courses. There can also be online courses. For example, virtual seminars or think tanks suppose a new kind of mobility, integration of staff in learning activities, collaborative learning activities between universities. So that's the development, European development in mobility. And skip this one. And I go directly to the definition of virtual mobility as it is given to by the European Commission. And the Erasmus Plus goal, virtual mobility is defined as a set of activities supported by information communication technologies, including e-learning, that realize or facilitate international collaborative experiences in the context of teaching, training, or learning. So it's a very long definition. We will make it a little bit shorter, but of course the main elements are that it is learning activities supported by ICT, e-learning, and international, and collaborative. Collaborative is very important in our understanding. As from the beginning, with Erasmus, mobility takes always place in a collaboration between two or more universities. So that's very important. If there is no collaboration between universities, there is no mobility in the sense as we understand this in Europe. So a student following an online course or a MOOC, that's not virtual mobility. That's just that's distance education, actually. So that's the difference. Mobility takes place in a collaboration between universities. Then, in the core concept of mobility, we have to understand that mobility is also always related to a formal course or curriculum. That's our, that's where our report is about. So mobility related to a formal course or formal curriculum based on a bilateral or a network consortium or a consortium agreement. When it is a joint course, we have a consortium agreement, for example. When it is just exchange, also in physical mobility, it's a bilateral agreement, as is the case in normal Erasmus mobility. And mobility is always guaranteeing the rights of the student by a student agreement. So one step further. Education can be organized in a face-to-face, in online, or in a blended mode. That's generally accepted today. So when you are on campus, mainstream education, you have, of course, face-to-face presential education, but you have also increasingly blended education, where face-to-face education is combined with online off-campus components. So that's blended education. And of course, when you're studying in a distance teaching university, for example, most of your learning activities are online. You're taught online. And well, when we talk about international education and also about mobility, that can also be organized face-to-face, online, and blended. It's quite quite logical. And so we can speak about physical mobility, blended mobility, and completely online mobility as well. There are a lot of developments in education that make that online education and also online mobility, virtual mobility will increase in the near future or in the future. And that's because we are working at universities more and more with learning management system. With there are more and more online courses. You can work with virtual classrooms. And there are also games in education, or serious games, virtual labs, simulations, and so on. All these developments, also developments in online continuous education and continuous professional development, make that there is a growing, that virtual mobility, online mobility, is also increasing, as is also is demonstrated by MOOCs, which have, of course, have shown a huge potential in terms of international accessibility and scale, quality of courses, and also effectiveness. So there are three types of mobility, actually: physical mobility, blended, or completely online mobility. When we talk about blended mobility, then you can have, of course, physical mobility, which is supported by online sessions before students are going out for Erasmus, for example, or when they are coming back, or before a summer school, and then when they are back from a summer school, and so on. But the opposite is also possible, that you have a seminar running a complete academic year or a semester, and that in the beginning of the seminar you have a week face-to-face physical mobility in one place in a network of universities, and at the end you have another week where, for example, students show the results of research they have done online and in learning communities and independently studying by themselves. So where they show these results to their colleagues at the other universities. So three types of mobility, as we see it. Additionally, we can say that mobility can be short-term, long-term, or intermittent. Short-term and long-term is very clear. Intermittent is perhaps not so clear. It, it, it's makes clear that mobility can take place from time to time over an academic year, and it's not just one period, but it can be many short periods over one academic year or over a semester, for example. Also, virtual mobility can be multi-campus, which is not the case with physical mobility. You can only be present on one place. And by internet, you can be present on many places together, many places simultaneously and together with more than two groups. One campus, but can also be three or four or five campuses. So it's perhaps not so clear, but you will see that on the slides later on when you receive the slides. There's a variety actually of mobility formats. So you have not just one for physical mobility format. Already in the Erasmus scheme, you had the classical Erasmus exchange, but also, for example, intensive programs. These were short term in most cases. Physical mobility can be only synchronous. It can be only, you can go only to one campus, or of course you can also go successively to many other campuses, but that's the limitation actually of physical mobility. Blended mobility can be short term, can be long time, can be synchronous, but also asynchronous. By asynchronous learning activities, where students may work independently for certain learning activities or learning tasks. It can be one campus, multi-campus. And as I told already, online mobility can support physical mobility, and the reverse can also take place where online mobility is supported by physical mobility. And online mobility, I must not explain anymore. It can be short term, long term, synchronous or asynchronous, and also one campus and multi campus. So actually, there's a lot of diversity in mobility formats, and we will see later that we have also tools for elaborating new innovative formats for mobility, be it physical, or blended, or online mobility. So it's not just three types. There are the by educational design, by the design of mobility formats, that you can be very innovative, and we will see that in the near future, a diversity of international educational formats, but also mobility formats, will emerge. In the task force, we have seen a lot of examples of virtual mobility. I will not talk about them all, but in our report, you will find also the links to all these examples. You can consider all these examples as innovative as far as they have developed themselves, and these examples, as far as the universities have developed new formats for mobility, new formats for education. For example, the virtual exchange based on MOOCs is a new format of mobility, which is elaborated, or which is designed and developed and brought in practice, always brought in practice by the Technical University of Delft and by Sorbonne University, the Sorbonne in Paris, and many other universities. Think tank Stellenbosch will be illustrated later on in this session by Katrien. Let's take Tempi, for example. There's blended training modules for medical physics experts. In that project, in the universities, the network has developed a lot of mobility windows for continuous education of medical physics medical doctors active in the field of radiology. Very interesting format, but all the others are also interesting, like UNIG, for example. In zone courses, humanitarian aid is made by the University of Geneva, and they explained the day after tomorrow by Barbara Moser. And that's actually a kind of, it's first mobility organized by the University of Geneva and the University of Kenya in the framework of a joint or a networked program with mobility windows. So a very interesting example as well. And so are all the others. Mobility is related to the curriculum, to a course or a curriculum. You can have embedded mobility within one course. So all cases, or most of the cases with virtual projects, virtual seminars, and so on, is small scale mobility in terms of time in most cases. And they are organized within a course. So the granularity of these activities is smaller than a course. Then you have exchange mobility for individual students. That's the virtual Erasmus scheme. That's the most practiced form of mobility. It's in most cases physical mobility, but it can also be online. But there is one problem with that kind of exchange. That the number of courses online in European universities is still very limited. In contrast with, for example, universities in the UK or universities in the US, where many more online courses are available within universities. So you can't organize exchange mobility comparable with the Erasmus scheme, the physical mobility, as long as you don't have online courses. Then we have networked courses, networked curricula with mobility windows, as I showed already with the project about medical physics. And then they have, of course, integrated mobility and joint curricula and joint degree programs, where part of the mobility paths can be as well online or blended or in a physical mode. In the Erasmus Mundus program, physical mobility was mandatory. It was not allowed to organize these mobility paths partially online or in an online mode. And so physical mobility was mandatory for all these students which registered for a joint master or a joint doctorate. So the physical mobility was and is an essential element. We think that, and is also already done also in practice, that part of these mobility paths, which are very expensive actually, can be done as well by online elements. In some of the Erasmus Mundus projects, we saw already lecture series, for example, or other learning activities online, but this was really very, very limited in size. It was for keeping the group of students, which were often in learning in different universities, to keep this group together by a learning community or a lecture series or discussions for the whole group, organized by a university. I skipped these new initiatives for a while, and I will then finalize my contribution by some considerations about international education design and mobility. So up to now, mobility was seen as an activity next to the curriculum. So Erasmus has not, the Erasmus scheme has not any impact on the curriculum, except that universities have started with teaching some of their courses in English when Erasmus students were present. So that was the main impact of mobility on the curriculum. But when you have networked curriculum, mobility windows, for example, where some specialized courses are given at one place in a network, and students can register for mobility, these mobility windows. In this case, of course, there is an impact on the curriculum because universities have to prepare mobility windows where students of partner universities will be introduced and they will be registered for. So there's a clear impact, and even more when you organize a joint degree, there's also a clear impact because the mobility paths are part of the degree program. So that's really, there's an interdependence between mobility and the structure of the curriculum. The same with a virtual seminar. You can't organize a virtual seminar if it is not organized by several universities and several staff of several universities together jointly. So there is a clear link between mobility and the course, the curriculum. So mobility has a clear function in the course, a clear function in the curriculum, and therefore you need course design or curriculum design. And so not very much would expect after all these years that there is something like international course and curriculum design. There's not so much, but what we have, of course, is theories about course design and curriculum design. And you can apply these theories then on the course, the on-course development and on-curriculum development. And well, in the report we have presented some weeks ago, we have develop some first ideas, some first steps for designing courses, international courses with mobility, for designing international curricula with mobility. And there, mobility is really part of the design. That's perhaps most clear when we talk about course design, when you organize a virtual program, a virtual course, a seminar, or a project. Then, of course, you make arrangements between staff of different universities, and you're distributing some teaching and learning activities, for example, over partner institutions, and you're sequencing these activities, and so that there is a set of learning activities which form together the seminar. So it's very, that's something that you will organize together jointly, which will staff organize jointly, starting from a joint concept for a seminar for a course. Therefore, we have these theories, and some other dimensions are also very important in this course design theories, for example, flexibility. How much flexibility do you need for such a seminar, for such a course? Learning communities, do you want to organize learning communities? How will you organize these learning communities? How will staff participate in these learning communities? These are all questions which have to be answered when you design a virtual seminar or a virtual project or also an online course. We have also to select media and modes of delivery. We have to look for a platform, not only a platform, you need also some software for learning communities, for example. You can also use media, some video material, and so on. And last but not least, the question of assessment is always very important. How can you assess students in an online learning environment with an assessment that is reliable and valid? In the case of examinations, that's really a vital question, and it's one of the main and the most difficult aspects in designing an online learning course. So these are some aspects of virtual mobility I wanted to share with you, and which are core elements in the report we have published recently. And of course, the report is available, and Lizzie will give you the links so that it is accessible for all of you. So in the future, perhaps we will continue with this aspect of international course design and international curriculum development. As I see it now, many universities start with online collaboration and with virtual mobility. It's really increasing, and that's also because of the new call of the European Commission around university networks that is stimulating really universities to look for kinds of collaboration and mobility which are not physical mobility or physical face-to-face collaboration. So that's completely new and innovative, and for many universities that start with this kind of new activities, certainly a headache in the beginning. But therefore, I think it's important that we share expertise and experience, and our experience in this sector. So that was it for the moment, and perhaps you can, if there are some questions or some issues or examples you want to share with us, so you're available for this now.
So thank you very much, Pete, for the interesting presentation. Are there any questions? I think everyone was all very clear. Thank you. Okay, then we can go straight away to the presentation of Katrien. So, Katrien van Elven from the KU Leuven, thank you.
We can still not hear you. A little bit louder, maybe. No, not really.
20 minutes ago.
I can hear you a little bit, but not very clear. Maybe you can put your microphone. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Is this better?
Yes, much better. Thank you.
Okay. Here we go. Afternoon. Again. So I'm Catherine from University of Leuven's International Office. I would like to talk to you about KU Leuven's and Omosh University think tank. It is one of the mobility initiatives mentioned in the report Innovative Models for International Collaboration and Mobility in Europe. The University of Leuven and Stellenbosch University are priority partners, and the partnership agreement includes university-wide staff mobility. It includes sandwich PhDs, but it also includes, for instance, a cooperation between the City of Leuven and Stellenbosch, and it includes a student think tank, an online student think tank. And this afternoon, I would like to present the KU Leuven Stellenbosch University think tank in a nutshell. I would like to share more detailed information on the format, and I would like to talk to you about lessons learned. I would like to share experiences. In a nutshell. The think tank is an extracurricular honors program. It's an international program and an intercultural program. It's predominantly online, but supported by two very short physical mobility periods. Each university, so the University of Leuven and University of Stellenbosch, each select 15 up to 20 students for the think tank program, and those can be students in any study field. Many different nationalities take part in the program. The past few editions include not only South African and Belgian nationals, but also students that are nationals from Nigeria, Namibia, Tanzania, Zimbabwe, Malawi, Germany, the Netherlands, Poland, Italy, Greece, Lithuania, Ukraine, Turkey, Romania, China, Indonesia, and the United States. We also had quite a few participants with double nationality, American, Turkish, Canadian, French, Canadian, Polish, German, Japanese participant, and so on. It is a very student-driven program. Students are asked, are given the opportunity to define content within a given central team, and they shape their own multidisciplinary research project. In doing so, they are coached by an international interdisciplinary team of academics. The think tank program includes regular work sessions, evening sessions, including video conference sessions with speakers, and online platforms and tools facilitate a collaboration between the students. And then there are two campus visits. During the Easter break, the students meet on campus for a very intensive focus week. And then in November, they participate in a campus workshop week, culminating in a concluding event where they present their findings, results of their research project to a broad okay, then for every edition, as mentioned, there's a given team. In 2015, the team was Making the City of the Future. In 2016, we had Brave New World, Emerging Technology and Society, on opportunities, challenges and threats for the quality of life. 2017, there the team was Art and Science, and the relationship between both. And then last year's edition was The Voice of the People. This year's edition started in February. This year's fifth edition, actually, the theme is health, well-being, and the future of healthcare. Physical and mental healthcare, as well as general well-being, have seen a clear evolution in recent centuries. And more than ever before, we find health and healthcare at the intersection of the three major scientific domains. So, humanities and social sciences, biomedical sciences, and science engineering and technology are joining forces to address challenges, present challenges, and future challenges. And this interdisciplinary approach makes that many opportunities arise. Technological innovations are making it possible to influence the course of life. These innovations, without any doubt, improve the quality of life of many, but they also raise a lot of ethical dilemmas. For instance, can we guarantee access to healthcare when costs rise due to highly advanced technologies? Many questions. The students have been exploring possibilities around this theme for a few months now, since February. More detailed information on the format of the think tank. What are the objectives of the think tank program? We want the students to deepen their knowledge, to share knowledge of their discipline, and to broaden it by outstepping the boundaries of their own field of study. They share insights and perspectives in direct dialogue with students and academics from various disciplines. They are asked to look at their own context and points of view in a different way. When they are confronted with students with a very different daily reality, different cultural context as well. They're challenged to think outside out of the box. They develop transferable skills, and focus is also on making sure that students gain experience in communicating experiences to a broad audience. In order to do so, we expect them to work 2 up to 3 hours a week on average, and obviously that depends on the phase the project is in. It depends on the progress that is made, and so on. The structure of the think tank program. Because of the differences in academic calendar, we start the program in February. And from February until May, we have evening work sessions every other week. Those include invited speakers and video conference sessions where both groups of students are present. Then, during the Easter break, the students gather on Campus 1, can be either in Leuven or in Stellenbosch, for an intensive focus week. This is a challenge because the Easter break is not always at the same time in Leuven and in Stellenbosch, which means that we have to find solutions there to make sure that students are excused from classes and so on. Then from July to August, so evening sessions continue right up until July. And then in July and August, students are asked to continue their work autonomously, according to an agreed timeline, but they choose how they divide the workload, to which channels they communicate, how frequently they are in touch over summer, they work on a progress report and a comprehensive content statement that they're asked to provide by the end of summer. They will receive feedback on those. And then from September up until November, they continue their work. They are continuously asked to send to report on the progress that they are making, actually, and they are working towards the workshop week. End of November, there is the workshop week with the concluding event on campus number 2. This concluding event, in which they present the results of their research, it can be anything, and it is up to them. So in 2015 and 2016, the students opted for a presentation followed by a debate discussion. In 2017, they organized their own exhibition, and last year's think tank group, they have made their own documentary film. Okay, in doing so, they are supported by a group of academics. They coach them. Their role is guidance, is being available, supporting the students. During the evening work sessions, they moderate, but just until a certain extent, only when it's necessary. They intervene only when it's necessary. Students are asked to, at first instance, students are asked to organize themselves and their discussions. Then, very important, they supervise the content of the research project, of the progress being made, and the timeline. If necessary, they provide contact details of relevant contact persons, can be an expert on a certain topic. And then finally, very important, they evaluate the students' participation in the program. Who is doing that? Well, there's two teams. There's a team of four faculty members involved at KU Leuven. We make sure that it's an interdisciplinary team in which the three academic or the three major study areas are represented. So humanities and social sciences, biomedical sciences, and science, engineering, and technology. And then there's two academics at Stellenbosch University. Important to mention, all of those are volunteers. Their workload for the evening sessions every other week will be about 3 hours. That includes the preparation for the session. And then regular follow-up would be about 1 hour a week, where they are coaching the students via email, answering questions, giving advice if necessary. Then during the focus week, during the Easter break, and during the workshop week in November, that is really intensive participation and coaching. Then, in addition to the academics, we have non-academic support staff. They are in charge of communication. They prepare the call for participants. They work on the website. They prepare the evening sessions, practically. And they are in touch with the students. They are a liaison person between the team in Stellenbosch and the team in Leuven. They organize all kinds of meetings, meeting of the selection committee, selecting the participants, and I'll come back to that right away. They organize evening sessions, as mentioned. They also organize the two campus visits, participation in events, and I'll come back to that as well. They follow up on the students' progress. If students don't show up for an evening session, for instance, those kind of things, and they keep a close eye on the budgets for the program. The team consists of one administrative staff at KU Leuven and two people at Stellenbosch University. They spent up until 4 hours on every evening session, and that includes the preparation, and about an hour a week on follow-up communication with the students and so on. And then also full-time availability during the focus week and workshop week. Then the profile of the students. We're looking for students that are master students at the start of the program. They should be master students at the start of the program. They should have an excellent academic record. They should be intrigued by the theme of that particular edition of the Think Tank program, and very motivated. Motivated to engage in a 10-month multidisciplinary research project, which is what it is. Motivated to invest in intercultural cooperation. They should be able to demonstrate a social commitment, interest in social issues. They should have a good working knowledge of English and excellent communication skills. They have to be looking for an extra challenge, and they should be open to self-reflection. They have to be willing to engage themselves in participating in the evening sessions, in the focus week and the workshop week, and they should make a clear effort to contribute. To contribute to the project and to collaborate with fellow students. Students are selected. We launch a call mid-October with a deadline on the 30th of November. And candidates are asked to submit an application file, including their CV, a motivation letter, a copy of their transcript of records, in addition to the close conditions for participation, the selection committee will also take into account the following elements in their selection process. The extent to which a candidate in his or her motivation letter shows affinity with the proposed team, the study progress of a candidate, if applicable, possible personal circumstances which may have influenced what we could consider a normal study progress. Finally, we're also looking into finding a right balance in representation of the three major scientific groups: science, engineering, technology, humanities and social sciences, and biomedical sciences within the whole group of selected participants. More information on the different parts of the program. We have two types of evening sessions. There's evening sessions that are only for the Leuven group or only for the Stellenbosch group. They include brainstorm sessions. They include sessions where a speaker is invited, followed by a discussion. There are also evenings where the students visit an organization, an event, they attend a lecture, anything related to the central team. And then, in addition to those separate evening sessions, there are joint sessions, joint evening sessions where all students participate, including via high quality video conferencing, where presentations and documents are shared on screen, where the discussion amongst the students is moderated, organized by the students themselves, but coaches intervene if it's necessary. During the Easter break, there's the focus week, as mentioned. The focus week the consists of content development. Content development via joint lectures, workshops, discussions. It is the time where decisions are made on substantive focal points, on the structure of the papers that the students are asked to write. Also consensus on the content of any sub-projects within the large research project carried out. And also, at this point in time, they should agree on the format of the output that they will deliver by the end of November. It's also the time for any clarification of the students' context, of South African context, of the Belgian context. That is a one-hour session led by the academic coaches. But of course, students or participants also informally talk about their personal background and context during this week and also during the evening sessions. There's time for community building and also for facilitating communication, which will facilitate the collaboration throughout the rest of the program. It's a time where the coaches stimulate collaboration, substantive process. They would, for instance, suggest breakout sessions if they see. Or if that seems necessary to them, and so on. Overall, the focus week includes about 60% of is about 60% of work sessions and on-topic activities. Those on-topic activities can be or have been in the past, for instance, a visit to the European Parliament, a visit to Science Café, where invited speakers with invited speakers, where there's debates in which all the students and staff participated. There was a visit to Health House, which is a visitor center which showcases the future of health and care. Then there's about 30% of team building activities, leisure activities, team sports, for instance. And then leisure activities, they include day trips, for instance, there was a day trip to Cape Town, with Table Mountain, Robben Island, District 6 Museum, when the focus week was hosted by Monsieur Leuven, students went on day trip to Bruges, for instance. And then there's 10% of free time. You can see some photos of previous editions of the focus week. Then in November, there's the workshop week with a concluding event. That is really focused on content, on formal elaboration of the concluding presentation of the results, and then. It includes a formal public presentation in the form of a symposium, can be a poster session, exhibition, debate, and so on. And then the cultural activities and trips, as mentioned. Also here, it's important to mention, as well as in the focus week, flexibility is key in the, drawing up this the program for this week. If more work time is necessary, leisure activities should be easy to cancel or to postpone. The workshop week includes about 55% of work sessions, 35% of leisure activities, and 10% of free time, and some photos of previous editions. Examples of concluding events. This is an example of last year's edition. Last year's Think Tank group made a documentary film, and this is the promotional material that was used to promote the first screening. Afterwards, the output is shared online. This documentary film will be soon available. It will be available soon on the dedicated web pages for the program. Very important here to mention is that the audience for the concluding event is a very broad audience, university students and staff, but also the broader public, family members, friends. Students promote the event via social media, but there's also promotion via the normal communication channels within both institutions. More examples of dissemination. These are two booklets. The Think Tank 2017 group organized an exhibition. The booklet on the left is the expo guide, and the one on the right is a booklet with all the papers and articles that the students have written. They were responsible for the content. They were also responsible for the layout, for instance, of these two booklets. Lots of work and work that is evaluated as well. There's a permanent continuous evaluation by the two teams of academics. And each team of academics evaluates their own students. How are they evaluated? Well, they should show a clear effort to contribute, to the project and to collaborate with their fellow students, both their fellow students in Leuven and in Stellenbosch. They should be present and they should participate actively during the evening sessions, the focus week and the workshop week. Students who take part during the whole program and who add value to the program, they receive a certificate stating their successful commitment to and participation in the program. It is a certificate signed by both institutions, signed by the academic coordinators. You can see an example. In addition to that, there is at University of Leuven, there's an extracurricular iPortfolio. The iPortfolio is an online portal. During the student days at KU Leuven, students connect and bundle different initiatives, social commitments, volunteer work, and so on and so on, in their portfolio on our online learning management system, Toledo. And at the end of their study program, they receive a certificate which lists all those programs, courses, all those things they successfully participated in. This is added, the certificate is added to their degree certificate, can be added to their CV and gives a nice overview. Feedback from participants. You can see feedback from Charlotte, who was a participant in last year's edition. She mentions that she learned a lot about teamwork across borders and that it was a challenge, not only because of the geographical distance, but also culturally, working attitudes, personalities as well. Yet she mentioned that it is one of the most pleasant teamwork projects that she's done so far. And now that she feels like she could handle any kind of teamwork she will encounter in the future. In addition, she mentioned that she's now confident that she really wants to pursue a research career. More feedback. Matthias from the think tank program, who participated in the think tank program last year as well, mentioned that after his graduation, his experience came in handy. When he started working, his employer organized a leadership training for young stagers, and he says that it was unbelievable how much he could go back to what he experienced, what he learned during the think tank program. He mentions that it's very useful in the workplace and that he often thinks back to the challenges he encountered and how they were solved. This is a statement from the 2017 group of students. They mentioned that it is truly an environment to think and to grow without the pressures of having to perform. That it is that freedom of thought and the interaction with so many different students that provided a space where they were not afraid to say what they really think, that it's unique and it is very challenging in different ways than the challenges faced in the more traditional courses or everyday life, that they are challenged out of their comfort zone and that they had to find a balance between doing things their way and allowing other people to take the lead. Niklas from that year's student group mentions that he would like to do it over. Lessons learned. The actual format is the result of 4 years of refinement and experience. What have we changed? One of the things that has been changed is an additional midterm campus visit. The academics found it necessary to improve the quality of the collaboration and the results. It was important for them to have the students meet in person during a very short physical mobility period in the middle of the program. It also reduced the academic coaches' workload. More lessons learned. It's very important to make sure that you have very clear goals, that you give the students very clear goals for each phase to guarantee an up to standard end result. So the overall timeline was adjusted a bit to end up with the one I presented earlier. There's also been some differences or lessons learned when it comes to coaching, finding a right balance between giving the students enough freedom, but also making sure that they stick to the timeline, managing conflicts, keeping students motivated because it is a 10-month program, how to consult the Stellenbosch team, the Leuven team, both students and academics. So lots of lessons learned, and one of the things that made it easier for this format at least was that the consistency of the team of academics involved it turned out to be important for the continuous improvement of the quality of the program to end up with the program that we have at the moment. I was very happy to be invited to present the KU Leuven Stellenbosch University think tank, I'd be happy to share some more experiences with you during the question and answer session later on. So if you have any questions, please ask, and if you have experience with a similar format, please share those experiences. Looking forward to hearing from you. Thank you.